is on Saturday at 4 p.m., but tomorrow night here in the sanctuary is choir practice. And I just want to take this opportunity to say thank you to Sean and all the ladies and guy on Sunday. Y'all did a marvelous, marvelous job. It was so, it was incredible. Thank you very much. Also, want you to know that next week I'm going to be wrapping up this series on building your confidence. And then on the 22nd, I'm going to be starting a new series called The Liberated Christian. And since we're going into Pride Month, and I'm going to be talking about how you can grow, how you can be liberated enough to fulfill your potential that God has for you. So I thought it would be a good series to follow up this one with. And so come and be with us on Wednesday night as we begin a new series on the 22nd called The Liberated Christian. Amen? And also on the 17th, we will have family game night and karaoke in Danko Hall. It's from 6:30 to, it begins at 6:30 until 9:30. And we always have a wonderful time. If you've never played Mexican train dominoes, it's lots of fun. There are other games going on. Bring a snack and let's have a wonderful, good time. I also want to remind you that Wings of Worship is practicing on the 18th at what time, David? Huh? 1 o'clock. And by the way, it ain't just for children. It's for all of God's children. And so come and be a part of it, okay? It's a wonderful great. Inquiries and membership class on the 18th at 10 o'clock in Danko Hall, and we'll provide a light lunch for those who come to that. Also, Rainbow Fish still has one opening for couples. If you want to really, really enhance your relationship, as a pastor, I strongly, strongly recommend that you check out Rainbow Fish. It's a wonderful weekend that will set you on a new trajectory in your relationship. And so we want you to be mindful of that. I want to remind you of two things that go on Sunday mornings. At 9:45, the youth group, grades 6 and up, meets every Sunday morning in the education building. You can see Alicia Griffin or Patricia Steele. Well, tonight I see John, because then I hear Alicia is on her honeymoon with Amanda, and of course, Patricia fell off the porch and broke her arm, so Lord have mercy. And the other thing is a Bible study series, adult Bible study class, The Lighthouse at 9 o'clock in Danko Hall. Right now they're studying the Bible, Bible that is you. And so we invite you to come and check out those educational opportunities as well. And so we thank you for being here tonight. If you love the Lord, say amen. Amen. If you love the Lord, say amen. Amen. Come on here, y'all. If you love the Lord, say amen. Amen. If you really love him, come on, let's stand on our feet and worship. Jesus is mine.
Jesus is my God. Tell me, Jesus. is with you. Everywhere you go, everywhere you be, he's yours. You don't have to conjure him up. He goes with you. If you make that affirmation, that's a good beginning on building your confidence in God. Amen? Everywhere I go, everywhere I be,
Thank you.
people we need to anoint tonight. John and Carrie, come with him. John's father's only got a couple weeks left. And most, and we want you to know that we love you. And we're with your family. Jeff, would you come? Jeff is having to go see a heart cardiologist. Is it tomorrow? And John, on behalf of your father and your family, I anoint you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. My brother Jeff, I anoint you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. If you feel comfortable in reaching forth your hands, please do it. Father, we come to you tonight. We lift up to you tonight, God. We first of all thank you that you are awesome God. We thank you for John's father and his long years. We believe and trust that you've given him a good life. And God, now as he's in the twilight days, we commit him into your presence, God. And we ask that you would just take him to be with that loving mother of John's who went before him. We ask that you would give him peace, to be at peace, knowing that to be absent from the body is to surely be present with you, Lord Jesus. And God, we claim tonight that your word is true, that whether we live or die, we are yours. And we count that to be true for his father. And God, I ask that you'd be with John and also Gary as they go through this time of transition. And we pray that you would let them know that your word is true. You promised you would not leave us nor forsake us, that you'd be with us to the end of the age. And so we're trusting you for it. And God, we lift up our brother Jeff tonight. We pray right now, Lord, that you would be with him, that you would guide and direct the cardiologist in whatever needs to be done. We know that you made this body. And we know that you're an awesome God. You're not just awesome in this place. You're awesome in this place of Jeff's body. And we commit him before you tonight, God. And we ask that you would be with him and anoint him as he go forth. Remind him of your word as well, that you will be with him as he go through these times. And now, God, as we go into this service, I ask that you would be with these your people. God, there's somebody here tonight needs a little lesson in building their confidence. There's somebody that doesn't know their purpose and plan that you have for them. God, I pray that you'd open their hearts and their minds to receive it and be fulfilled by it. For we pray it in Jesus' name. You are welcome in this place, Lord Jesus. And we commit the service to you because you are awesome in this place. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you turn to those near you and welcome them as we sing?
Thank you.
people said?
Good evening. You know, here at Covenant, we are family. And as family, we rejoice together. In times of rejoicing, we cry together. In seasons of sadness, we worship God together. Here at Covenant, we feel the love of Jesus Christ. When we sing Jesus is mine, we know it down deep. Jesus is mine. To help us continue to reach so many people here in Birmingham and all around the world online, we do count on your tithes and offerings. So please, give what you can tonight. We really do appreciate it. Ushers, if you'll come. So much for this church and for all that you're doing in our lives and in this ministry. And Father, I pray that you'll bless these tithes and offerings, Father, and bless all of those who gave tonight. And Lord, all of those who give in spirit and those who give in prayer and in time. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. That Baptist up there talking about the Holy Ghost. Amen. Last week I started a lesson called, it was the fifth part of our lesson on replace condemnation with confidence. And I just gave you I gave you five things last week. I'm not going to go over them in detail. I'll hit them very quickly because there's one last point on that I wanted to talk about that stands all by itself. And so often it keeps us from really, really unlocking the door. And it's the key that unlocks the door to real confidence. And so I want us to hit that and go on. I told you last week that I started by telling you that you probably have already found out that your confidence has a tendency to ebb and flow. One day you're up, the next day you're down. Depending on circumstances, you might be feeling great about yourself, and then another time you may not be feeling that great about yourself. And there's a great passage that tells us that what's going on inside, what causes that is what's going on inside of you. In 1 John 3:21, it says, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence in God. And that's the key right there, because for too many of us, our heart condemns us. We have listened to stuff that other people have laid on us. We've listened to stuff that we have put on ourselves, faulty concepts that we have of God, things that were never true, we still believe them, and it causes us to feel condemned. Now, the problem isn't that you, from time to time, will allow yourselves to feel condemned, but the problem is when you live there. Somebody said, you know, I can't keep a bird from passing over my head, but I can keep it from building a nest up there. And some of us you can't keep a condemnation from coming at you from various sources, but you can keep it from building a nest in your heart and in your mind. Because when you don't, it destroys your confidence. And so how do you get from that destroyed confidence and that living under condemnation to once again living with confidence? Simple. Well, maybe not that simple. But you replace condemnation with confidence. And the way you do that, I gave you some steps to do that. We'll look at them very briefly tonight. And then we're going to center in on number 6. Because that's the anchor. Okay? Let us pray. God, we thank you that you are a great God. We thank you that you call us to be your people. We thank you that you are a loving God, and you do not want us as your children to walk in condemnation, but to walk in confidence before you. And so tonight, God, once again, I ask you to let these lips of clay speak your word, that we might boldly proclaim your glory and your great name. That these your people might apprehend a little truth that replaced their condemnation with confidence. For we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Sister here probably is going to feel a lot more confident as soon as that school year is over. I want to say congratulations to her. She's going to be retiring in just a few more days. Amen. Praise God. And we thank God for that. I don't know if we're thanking God for it or we're just praying you come back safe. Some sisters are going to Alaska. Lord. Did I ask her that? But I was texting Jackie over church matter, and Jackie said, Lord, I'm going to have to medicate this girl. Sedate is the word, wasn't it? Sedate. She's all right. We were wishing you all have a great trip. And any of you, I know that John and all of them are going. It's that time of year that you go. And the reason I'm mentioning these things is because, you know, sometimes we forget that that's part of one of the ways, getting away sometimes, and those kind of changes oftentimes will help us with our confidence, because sometimes you can get so caught up into what you do that you forget to nourish yourself. And that also can be a source of destroying your confidence. Last week I looked at what was the cause of self-condemnation, and there were two things that we really talked about, and one was unresolved guilt. And David said in Psalm 32, when I hold on to my guilt inside, I'm miserable. And what he's saying there is guilt destroys your confidence. And so many of us allow guilt to destroy our confidence. The other thing was unrealistic expectations. Some of you are just perfectionists. Let's face it. And what is the perfection? This feeling, I've got to be flawless. I've got to be perfect. I got to please everybody. I have to always do more. Perfectionists feel guilty when they relax. And so both of those things, guilt and perfectionism, will destroy your confidence because it's you doing it. The first letter in both of those phrases is you. You're the one that's doing the unresolved guilt. You're the one doing the unresolved expectation. Now, some other people can try to put those on you, but it can't work unless you allow it. Okay? And so, how do you replace, then, this condemnation with confidence? And let me just very quickly go through these five things that we did last week. Number one was what? Accept God's forgiveness. You don't need to carry around a load of guilt. Romans 3 and 22, all of us are sinned and all fall short of God's ideal, yet God declares us what? If we trust in Jesus Christ, who in his kindness freely takes away our sin. You need to simply accept God's forgiveness. It's yours. When you ask for it, it's yours. Don't let anybody try to give you this guilt trip or all these things you got to go through to get to it. That's just not true. If you said, God, forgive me, you're forgiven. It's just that simple. And you know what the problem is? We think, well, that's too easy. Got to be more to it than that. But it's not. You say, God, forgive me, it is forgiven. And so after that, the problem, though, the reason that many of us still feel guilty is the next one. And what's that? See, we believe God forgives. We don't forgive ourselves. We don't forgive. Boy, I talked about that on Sunday, too. I didn't know the lectionary was going to follow me last Sunday. But we talked about that on Sunday. Forgive yourself. You know? If God forgive you, shouldn't that be a clue that you're forgivable? So forgive yourself. Stop beating yourself up. God wants you to forgive yourself. Proverbs 4, 25. Look straight ahead with honest confidence and don't hang your head in shame. In other words, forgive yourself. I love that quote I gave you last week. Someone asked the former First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt, how do you accomplish so much in your life? And she said, I never waste time with regrets. That's a woman who's learned to forgive herself. And you would do well to do that as well. Accept God's forgiveness and forgive yourself. Third thing was what? It means you, what that really means, you don't have to be perfect for God to love you. If that was true, God would never love you. But it ain't dependent on you. This is about God. It ain't about you. Amen? Proverbs 1 and 103, 13, 14. As a father is kind to his children, so the Lord is kind to those who honor him. Psalm 119, 96 said, nothing is perfect except God's word. And you ain't God's word, so you ain't perfect. God knows what we're made of. Verse 14 of 103. God knows what we're made of. God remembers that we are dust. And what that means is God completely understands you. God knows everything about you. He knows all your failures, all your shortcomings, all those things. And God still loved you. Every stage of development in your life, from before you were born, when you was a little baby, when you was a toddler, when you was an adolescent, when you was a teenager, giving everybody hell around you, and now as an adult, giving everybody hell. He still loves you. That's the point. Amen? And there ain't anything you can do to make him love you anymore. There ain't nothing you can do to make him love you any less. God has established that he loves you. And so you, and that's called, since it's not dependent on what you do, that's called grace. So you need to learn to relax in God's grace. God loves me. If you just relax in that thought, perhaps you can have more confidence in your life. You don't live on the edge so much if you just learn to relax in that God loves me. Amen? Yeah. You don't have to walk around with all this unresolved guilt and unrealistic expectations. God's love is unconditional, not based on what you do. Romans 8 and 11, there is therefore now no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. What that means is God, you know, when Jesus wraps me in his love, God looks at Jesus. God doesn't see me. God sees me in Christ. You know what it means to be in Christ? Let me just show you. This is you. It's a mess. Okay? It's a mess. This is Christ. You are in Christ. He looks, he didn't see you. He sees the blood. You come, when you accept Christ, he sees the blood of Jesus covering your life. He sees you as perfect. Amen? That's what it means to be in Christ. God doesn't see your sin. That means that you can relax in God's grace. And I know that that is a hard one for us to swallow. Because so many of us have been beat up so badly that God sees everything you do. We think God is Santa Claus. He's making a list and checking it twice. He knows when you've been naughty and nice, and you've been naughty a lot more than you've been nice. And that's not God. That's some man-made up idea about Santa Claus and God. Amen? It wasn't true to begin with. But you bought into it, and so you got to learn to unlearn. You got to unlearn that and learn to relax in God's grace. And then number four was what? Who's your worst critic? Usually yourself. Proverbs 4:23, be careful how you think. Your life is shaped by your thoughts. A lot of us are like Job in Job 9 and 20, when Job says, everything I say seems to condemn me. Everything that seems to come out of some people's mouth beat themselves up. I know I ain't this, but I know I. You gotta learn to eliminate. You are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's who you are. That's who God sees you as. But if you don't see yourself as that, you are constantly spewing this stuff out of your mouth. And let me tell you something. Words have power. You become your confession. I am, I am, I am. Now, whatever you put after that I am is what you'll become. Amen? Some of you need to be pregnant. They're thinking, where is he going with that? Some of you need to be pregnant with affirmations of who you really are in God until it becomes a reality, until it gives birth in your life. That's what I mean. Oh, bless your heart. Let me tell you something. God wants you to stop putting yourself down. Learn to affirm yourself. The Bible says, as a person thinks in his or her heart, so is that person. How do you eliminate self-talk from your, and become more confident? The principle of replacement. It's the principle of replacement. Paul says it this way. It was the lectionary Sunday. When I did the lesson, I didn't know it was going to be lectionary Sunday. Listen, fix your thoughts on what is true and good and right. Think about all you can thank God for and be glad about it. There is something in your life you can give God thanks for. You woke up this morning. You wasn't on a cooling board. And it's better to be seen than viewed. Amen? You can breathe. You got a reasonable portion of health and strength. Even if some of us had to take a leave today. Well, hallelujah. You have a reasonable portion of health. There's something in your life that you can give God. Instead of complaining about what's wrong, start giving some thanks. Start affirming who you are in Christ Jesus. When you're tempted to say, I can't, say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And what that really means is, I can do everything that God wants me to do. Doesn't mean I can go out here and jump off a mountain. The law of gravity will take over. If I go to the top of the Empire State Building and jump off, nobody has to write in the paper tomorrow morning, you know, the Lord threw him to the ground. Gravity did that. That's an established law. Well, you know what? You know another law is just as established as that? Is God loves you. Amen? I remember, any of you know who Meadowlark Lemon is? The Harlem Globetrotters fame. I was watching him on one of the Gaither videos once, and he was talking about Peter walking on the water, and he said, come on, y'all, Peter can't walk on the water. You can't walk on water. But you can walk on your faith. Peter was walking on his faith. And I can do all things in Christ Jesus. You need to start. You can't walk on the water of your life, but you can walk on your faith. And some of you need to walk on your faith and start eliminating that evil talk. What do? You need to put some word in you. I want you to take this. I gave you, this is a second chance to take this sheet with you and memorize some of these scriptures, because you're going to need them at some point in your life. You ain't going to have your Bible handy. Very few of you carry one. I'm looking around. Don't tell me I got it on the phone. Some of you can't even got it on your phone. Don't try to call me and let me cut it off when you call me. I actually do have 65 translations on my phone, because I like to read different translations. Okay? Learn, memorize, start affirming yourself in God. Let God remold your mind. Be careful how you think. Your life is shaped by your thoughts. Eliminate negative self-talk. Number five was what? Only a fool tries to do what God cannot do. God cannot please everybody. If it was so, Jesus wouldn't have ended up on a cross. Unfortunately, some of y'all are on the cross. As that great theologian Dolly Parton said, get off the wood, honey. Get off the cross. Somebody else needs the wood. Amen? Yeah. And you know what? Trying to please everybody is the biggest root there is of insecurity. Quit trying to please everybody. Proverbs 29 and 25. It is dangerous to be concerned with what other people think about you. Why is it dangerous? Because you're always out there trying to please them and you don't have time to please God. Quit trying to please everybody. Romans 8, 31. If God be for us, who can be against us? You know, a lot of people say, well, I know a lot of people against it. You don't get the context of this. The verb usage in the original Greek really translates this way. If God is for us, it doesn't matter who's against us. That's what the writer is really saying. If God is for us, it doesn't matter who's against you. So what if a few thousand people don't like you? There's still 330-some million people in this country. Find something to do. Amen? Quit trying to please everybody. Accept God's forgiveness. And I told you last week there was one more point that I wanted to deal with this week because it opens the door. Number six. Let's hang our hat on it. Number six is what? You focus only on doing God's will. What do I mean by that? I mean, don't worry about the rest. Because that's the key of the confidence in your life. It simplifies your life if you're trying to focus on God's will. All of a sudden, you're not trying to please crowd A and falling out of favor with crowd B. You're trying to please crowd C. About time you got them, please crowd D is upset with you. Let me tell you something. Let me give you a little secret to a pastor's life. Even today, it happened today. You cannot please. Somebody's going to get mad at you. And if you ever think you're going to be a leader of anything and not have people get mad at you, you are nuts. People are going to be mad at you. And all you can do in those times is do your best. There's always going to be somebody who thought you should have done this at this time. Let me tell you, how many board members are here right now? Oh, okay. Only one. and he actually is a friend, so I can get away with it. Let me tell you something. There have been so many occasions when the board thought I should act on something. And they thought I didn't act on it. Well, that's board staff members too. And I didn't act on it when they thought I should. And people got upset with me. But you know what? 9 times out of 10, I was right in moving in the time I did, as opposed to the time they thought I should. There may be yet one time, because ain't nobody perfect. Nobody perfect but the Word of God. Amen? There are times I screwed it up, okay? Let's be honest. I'm not ashamed to say it. There were times of good, but more times than not, when I moved when I did, it's because I felt it was the right time to do it, and I saw a bigger picture than they did. And if you're going to see a bigger picture than people around you and your leader, they're going to get mad with you. And what you have to do at that time is you have to focus on doing God's will and not the board's will. They're not mutually exclusive. Amen? Everybody wants me to be something different, depending on the perspective. Guess what? The same is true about you. Everybody, sister, when you drive that bus, the parents of the kids who you pick up first want you to be a certain person. The people you pick up a little closer to school want you to be something else. That when you get to the school, they want to be something. And then those people you answer to at the school want you something. Everybody wants something different from you. And you'll drive yourself crazy if you try to fulfill all those things to all those people. So how do you get around it? You focus on pleasing God. On doing what God has asked you to do. Let me just put this on the table. Most of you are doing too much right now. Even with church stuff, you're doing too much. Now, I understand it if it's church stuff, okay? I understand it. People who are really committed, they see a need, and it's not being addressed, so they want to jump in and fulfill it. And that's admirable, and I understand it. And I pray that you can, then you'll do some of that. But let me tell you something. For some of you, your schedules are too busy. Your schedules are too busy. You're doing way too much. You have too many irons in the fire that you're about to put that fire out. You're smothering it. And if you're burning the candle at both ends, you're not as bright as you think you are. Amen? Years ago, back when I was probably 8 or 9, you know, 20 years ago, the Time magazine had this cover. It was a long time ago, called The Rat Race. And it was called How America is Running Itself Raggedy. And you ask why, and it says, and it boiled down to unresolved guilt and unrealistic expectations and perfectionism, if you read through that thing. And the first sentence of the article says, if you have a moment to read this story with your feet up, free of interruptions, at your leisure, put it down. It's not for you. And it talks about yuppies. Do any of you even know what a yuppie is? Okay, that's a term for folks before Generation X, Generation XY, and Generation XYZ. Okay? But if it was true back then, how much more is it amplified and on steroids today? Okay? It says people's lives are so busy that they just merely to give somebody the time of day seems like an act of charity. And it goes on to say, we are out of time. Why? It's because we're always trying to prove something. Unrealistic expectation, unresolved guilt forces people into a runaway mode because they're afraid to settle down and get quiet. Because they're afraid that this sense of failure will somehow begin to seep in if I just sit down and relax. Therefore, what I'm trying to do is learn to live by grace, and you need to learn it too. As Paul said over in the 3rd chapter of Philippians, not that I've attained it, but I'm pressing on towards the mark. Amen? I ain't got there yet, but come and go with me, because I'm going there. Amen? How do you know when you're doing too much in life? How do you know when you've been pushed by perfectionism or pushed by guilt rather than motivated by God? How do you know when you're out of God's will? How do you know if all the things you're doing are what God expects you to do or you're putting those expectations on yourself? How do you know when you are absolutely, positively doing too much? It's very simple. Very simple. You're always tired. You're always tired. If it's not a medical reason and you're always tired, that's it. It's not God's will for you in life to always be tired. It's not. God never intended for you to go around with a heavy load. Let me share some scripture with you. Matthew 11th chapter, 29th and 30th verse. Jesus said, this is one of the most important verses in life. Jesus said, come to me, all you who are tired from carrying heavy loads, and I will give you. Does he say, I'll give you more loads? Is that what he's saying? I'll just dump more on you? We'll just add a few more things to your schedule? No, he's not saying. He said, I will give you rest. The yoke I give you is easy, and the load I will put on you is light. That word yoke right there. The yoke right there he's talking about is not the kind of yoke that most of you would associate with the word yoke. It's not that kind of yoke that bind two cattle together. You know, that's a yoke when you put that thing around both of them's neck to make them go the same way, pull the same time. That's a yoke. But that's not the kind of yoke that's talked about here. The yoke that's talking about here is more like the ones that you see pictures in Europe and other places where folks carry this crossbar across their neck to carry two pails and things on there. That's the kind of yoke that Jesus is talking about here. You know, when they carry the two pails of milk on the stick, that's the kind of yoke that Jesus is talking about there. And let me tell you something. Everybody is carrying a yoke. You're carrying one, and I'm carrying one. You're carrying one this evening. Let me ask you, what's got you burdened down? Is it a financial problem? Is it guilt? Is it a relational problem? Is it resentment towards somebody? Is it bitterness? Did you know that expectations is a yoke also? Some of you are carrying a yoke, a heavy burden tonight. It's expectation. Some of you are carrying expectations that were put on you by your parents years ago. Some of you are carrying a burden, a yoke that's been put on you by your spouse or your children. Some of you are carrying a burden, a yoke that's been put on you by your boss, or maybe somebody at school, or by society. Most of us carry a yoke that we put on ourselves because of unresolved guilt, unrealistic expectations. We're trying to prove that we matter. Listen, babies, you do matter to God. You don't have to prove anything. You, because God created you, you matter to God. You don't have to ask God or anybody else whether you matter. We put so many of those things on ourselves. I just want to leave you with three questions about this text tonight from Matthew. Number one, what is God's yoke? He says, come put on my yoke. Take off your heavy one and put on mine. What is this yoke? I put it there. What is it? It's his plan and his purpose for your life. And even though the two of you might be going on a cruise together, God's plan and God's purpose for your lives are different. Just as different as day and night. Yours and his are different. Amen? You might can wear each other's clothes, but your purpose and your plan are different. Amen? You need to understand that. That God's purpose and God's plan for your life. Y'all been together 11 years, 12 years, something like that? just as different as day and night. Of course, y'all already know that, right? And don't you forget it. You were made for a purpose. You were made for a reason. God has a plan for you. And when you go down whatever track God's on, it's okay. The problem is when you try to make your track for yourself. Believe me, I know. I had mine laid out. I had that thing laid out well. I thought I did it better than God. Didn't work out that way, but I thought it. You see, you know, and this is the thing. When you go down to that track that you think is best for you, not the one God laid out for you, boy, you're going to have some problems. Amen? When you go down the one God lays out for you, things going to work out a little better. No, they're going to work out a lot better. When you go on your own way, when I've done that, I hit one brick wall after another. And then God says, put on my purpose. Put on my plan. What is God's yoke? It's God's purpose and God's plan for my life. It isn't Jeanette's plan for my life. It's God's plan for my life. It isn't JR's plan for Jeanette's life. It's God's plan. How long have y'all been together now? Has it been that long? God, time flies. And as much as you've grown together in that time, your plan is quite different than hers. Both of you sing in the choir, and you do beautifully. But your plan is still different. God's plan and purpose is still different. Because one of you is soprano and one of alto. One of you can hear and the other one can't. Okay? Now, let me ask you, how heavy is God's yoke? Light what? He says, take the yoke I will give you, it's light and easy. You notice that word easy. Light, bearable, easy. You said, but my Christian life isn't easy. My Christian life is a heavy burden. My life is a heavy burden. Then you're out of God's will. You're on your own track. And guess what? Good Christians can be on their own track. Good Christians saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost and going to heaven can be on their own track. Amen? I don't know how to make it any more correct and plainer than that. If you're out of God's will, it's going to be heavy. You need to look at what you're doing. And some of the things you're thinking, God, you need to look at and see if some of the things you think that God is asking you to do, is God really asking you to do? Because, you know, your conscience or your perfectionism might be the one that's asking you to do it. Amen? Amen. He said, are you saying that my relationship with Christ, the Christian life is easy? No, I'm not saying that at all. Jesus said, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. But let me tell you something. Jesus didn't come to give you a burden. He came to give you a blessing. Amen? Now, am I saying that the Christian life has no problem? You know better than that nonsense. You do have a lot of, you are going to have a lot of problems. Some of the problems just come with living. I told Sister Day I had to take a leave for these knees today. They weren't working. I mean, that isn't because God has put arthritis in my knees. No, that's called living. Amen? Amen. The Christian life will have difficulties. I'm guaranteeing you that. But this is what I'm trying to tell you. To live in the center of God's will be a lighter load than to live outside of God's will. That's what I'm telling you. To live God's purpose and God's plan for your life is lighter, it's more relaxing, and it's more enjoyable. It takes less of a toll on you mentally, emotionally, and even physically. Amen? And if you say, that my life, my Christian life is a burden on me right now, there's something you're doing in your life that God never intended you to do. Some of you are doing things that God never intended for you to do. Not that they are bad things. You see, we like black and white, don't we, Scotty? It ain't always black and white. You may be doing some good things, but it's wearing you out because it's not what God called you to do. That's why from time to time, you need to do a spiritual gift inventory because it changes. And you need to see where you're gifted at and work in the areas of your giftedness, because some people are working in the area that they were gifted 5 and 10 years ago, but their giftedness has changed. And so they're doing good things, but they're working outside of God's will at this point in their life. It's not that they're doing bad things, but they're working outside of God's will. And don't you ever think that, never mind. You know what I mean. Some of us are stuck on that cover of Time magazine. How is America running itself raggedy? What is God's yoke? His plan and his purpose. How heavy is it? It's light. It's easy. And the third question, how do you put on God's yoke? If you want to have his yoke, what do you need to do? Study the Bible harder? Never miss church? Always be perfect? And you need to come to church. Be sure to take communion at least once a week. Witness to everybody you see in sight. Be a Bible thumper. Is that what he's saying? No. Listen, come to me, all you who are tired from carrying your heavy load, and I will give you rest. I'll repeat that. Some of you didn't hear it. Come to me. Jesus is speaking, not J.R. All you who are tired from carrying your heavy load, and I will give you rest. Notice he did not say, if you want to get rid of your stress, come to church. He didn't say, if you want to get rid of your stress, come to the Bible or come to a seminar. He said, come to Christ. Come to me. The answer to your stress is not a bunch of principles. The answer to your stress is a relationship with God's Son. Come to me, and I will give you a deep, abiding, gut-level rest for your life. What Jesus is really saying is, every last one of us wear a yoke in life. And he's saying, let's swap. I'll take yours. You take mine. I'll take the heavy burden that you have. You take the one I have because it's light and it's easy. It's not going to stop every problem you have in life. You're going to have life. Jesus himself said, in this world you're going to have tribulation. But he's trying to tell you, if you take my yoke, your way is going to be lighter. You see, because that same Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. You're going to have to take up the cross, okay? You're going to have to take up the cross. But if you take it up and follow him, it'll be easier. Amen. That's what he's saying. Amen? Let me tell you something. Let me ask you tonight. Are you living under condemnation in your life in any area? Are you living under condemnation in the area of your relationship? Are you living under condemnation in the area of your finances? Are you living under condemnation in the area of your walk with the Lord? Does it have you thinking you're not worthy of God's mercy? Does it have you thinking you're not worthy of God's grace in your life? Jesus offers you an invitation. Come to me, and I'll give you rest. If Jesus Christ could stand here in front of you and get talk to you face to face tonight, if he could just sit down on these steps and have you sit down there with him, and just, if he could just come up behind you where you're sitting right now, put a hand on your shoulder, say, let me talk to you about something. It don't have to be this way. I want to give you rest. I want you to have confidence. I want you to know that you know that you know that I love you. We okay together. And I want you to know how to not walk around stressed all your life. I want you to focus on Daddy's will for you. I think you'd say, why don't we do this? Why don't we take this heavy yoke off of you carrying right now? Take it off and put it over here. And instead, let me put mine on you. And why don't you put this one on and get rid of that grace? Let's replace the guilt with grace. See how much better that fits than that old tired condemnation yoke? You are going to wear a yoke in your life. Everybody does. The question is, will it be a heavy one that you put on yourself? Or will it be the light one that you allow Christ to put on? Why don't you take off that heavy yoke of perfectionism in your life? Always trying to please somebody. Always trying to prove yourself to somebody. And Jesus said, why don't you just toss it off over there? It don't fit anyway. And you're a fashion queen. Put on something that fits. Put on my yoke. It fits. It's comfortable and it's light. It's easy. When you do that, your confidence will begin to soar. Take this with you tonight. Begin to affirm yourself. Some of you need to just realize you are forgiven. Whatever that thing is that sticks out in your mind that keeps coming up every time you hear this and you've asked God to, you need to understand it is forgiven. He has thrown it in the sea of forgetfulness. He's thrown that big sign up there that says no fishing here. And so accept that forgiveness and forgive yourself. Do all the rest of those things, but most of all, if you really want your confidence to soar, you get to the place where you focus on God's will and you learn that His yoke is easy and His burden is light. And that's what He wants for you. Are worthy of it. You're worthy because God loves you. You're worthy because Christ died for you. And you're worthy because you're God's child. You are worthy. Let's stand and sing, "We Are Worthy."
We are worthy. To receive grace.
everybody's house.
Grace in abundance.
Grace abundant
and free.
For you are our maker, and we are his children. We are created like thee. And in the image, we are created to live in wholeness with thee.
As you leave tonight, I pray that this message will make an impression on your heart. I really, really do pray that you will learn. Take those steps, those six steps. Practice them in your life. Because I really do believe, more than anything else, a little confidence goes a long way in your walk with Christ. Would you repeat after me? May the Lord watch between me and thee. While we're absent, one from the other. Amen.